Hello everyone, it is a pleasure for me to present at Indocrypt this year and thank you for watching my presentation. I'll talk about the cryptanalysis of the permutation-based algorithm SpoC, which is a joint work with Raluca, Posteuca and Vincent, Rijmen. We focused our attention on the cipher SpoC, which is a second round candidate to the NIST lightweight competition, which started at 2019. The competition aims at standardizing a portfolio of lightweight algorithms with a focus on authenticated encryption schemes and hash functions. The security requirements are at least 112 bits of security, and the ciphers need to satisfy certain criteria for performance. Currently, the competition is on its second round with 32 ciphers left, and the third round candidates would be announced at the end of this month. In this work, we constructed round-reduced differential characteristics for the sly SEP light permutation, which is the permutation used in SpoC. Then, using these characteristics, we present tag forgery attacks on both SpoC versions. Furthermore, a key recovery attack on SpoC64, regardless of the permutation, and the message recovery attack based on the characteristics are presented. Finally, some observations on the constants used in the permutation are given. My presentation will continue as follows. I'll first introduce the algorithm of SpoC and the concept of differential cryptanalysis. Then I'll show our differential characteristics of the permutation and how we use them for the tag forgery attacks. Further, I'll present the message and key recoveries on SpoC64 and finally the observations on the constants used in the permutation. This is a diagram of the mode of operation of SpoC. SpoC is a sponge construction and therefore the state is divided into rate and capacity bits. The authors introduce masked capacity bits, which is where the message and associated data are added. The mode of operation consists of the following phases: initialization, associated data processing, message processing, and tag generation. The initialization is the only part that is different for the two SpoC versions. Here you can see the initialization for SpoC64. After loading the nonce, the key and half of the nonce to the state, the permutation is applied and then the second half of the nonce is added. For SpoC128, this phase consists only of loading the key and the nonce to the state. The associated data and message processing phases are very similar. After each block is absorbed to the state, a control signal is added to the rate part. The value of this constant depends on the phase and the length of the block. The ciphertext is then obtained from the message processing phase by XORing the message and the rate bits. The permutation used in SpoC is the sly SEP light permutation. The left figure shows one step of this permutation. First, the state is divided into four equal subblocks. Then a SBox layer is applied to half of the state and a constant is added to the other half of the state. Finally, the subblocks are permuted. The SBox used in the permutation is the SIMEC cipher with a constant instead of a key. And the round of the SIMEC cipher is shown at the left. For completeness, I am listing the parameters for both SPOC versions and the corresponding permutations. Note that both versions of SPOC use 128 bits key and nonce, with different rate and tag size. For the permutation, we have different size of the SBox and different number of SIMEC rounds, while the permutation steps are the same. This table summarizes the security claims of the authors. As we interpreted them, the best attack on either version of SpoC should use at most 2 to the 50 data encrypted under the same key and has a time complexity of at most 2 to the 112. Furthermore, the attack aiming at either breaking the confidentiality or the integrity of the cipher should have a success probability of at least 2 to the minus 16. At first sight, it seems that all our attacks have complexity more than 2 to the 50 data. However, our attacks use different keys and therefore the restrictions are satisfied. Differential cryptanalysis is one of the most powerful and used cryptanalysis techniques against symmetric primitives. The basic idea is to take two plaintexts with a difference only in few bits and follow how this difference propagates throughout the whole algorithm and the ciphertext. By taking the difference before and after each round, we define a differential characteristic as the sequence of all intermediate differences. If we assume that the rounds are independent and the keys are uniformly distributed, we can compute the expected differential probability of a characteristic by multiplying the single round's probabilities. However, in practice, we can often only observe the input and output differences, so we call the pair of input and output differences AB a differential. Generally, computing this probability is a very difficult task since it is the sum of the probabilities of all possible characteristics with the same input and output mask. Therefore, what is done in practice is to bound this probability with the probability of the optimal characteristic. For our experiments, we used the SAT solver-based tool ARXPy to search for optimal characteristics over the CIMAC S-box of the permutation in order to compute the differential probability of the S-box. Our differential characteristics are constructed over round-reduced versions of the permutation, and we impose some constraints on the input and output differences in order to use them later on for the attacks on SpoC. So the characteristics that I will show you are not the optimal ones in general, but the best ones for our attacks. This is our characteristic of the 256-bit version of the permutation. It covers 6 out of 18 rounds with 6 active S-boxes, and we have constraints only on the output difference, fixing the first and third sublocks to delta 1 and 0. The purpose and value of this delta 1 I'll explain later. The difference in the other two sublocks is chosen in a way to minimize the active S-boxes at the last rounds. So in this way we have only two S-boxes in the last 3 rounds. In fact, the constrained first and third sublocks actually correspond to the rate bits of the cipher. The best probability we have for this characteristic is 2 to the power minus 106. To construct this characteristic, we use the ARXPy tool to find optimal characteristics of the S-boxes and link the input and output masks. Then we empirically calculated the differential probabilities of the S-boxes over the chosen differences in order to obtain the probability of the characteristic. Here you can see our 9-round characteristic of the 192-bit version of the permutation. It covers 9 out of 18 rounds with 8 active S-boxes. Here we put constraints again on the output, but this time we fix the first and third sublocks to 0 and want a difference only on the second and the fourth sublocks. And these sublocks correspond to the capacity part of the cipher. The best probability we have is 2 to the power minus 109. Our tag forgery attacks are based on several observations on the algorithm of SpoC. First, note that a null associated data or an empty message means that the corresponding phase is completely skipped. Furthermore, a different constant is added at each phase and depending on the block length. Finally, the initialization of SpoC 128 consists only of loading the key and nonce to the state. Here you can see how the processing of only one block of message with no associated data would look like. And I'll try to give you the intuition behind our attack. Assume that we have a no associated data and two one block messages, an incomplete block M and a complete block M star, which is the padded M. If we process the two messages under the same key nonce pair, then the only difference in the processing will be the different control signal that is added. If we manage to cancel that difference, then the internal states will be the same and therefore the produced tags would be equal. We looked for characteristics of the permutation such that the output difference in the rate part is the sum of those constants, and this is exactly the convenient difference delta 1 for which I talked about. In these figures, you can see the encryption process of the messages from the previous slide under the related key-related nonce pairs chosen in accordance to our characteristic. If our characteristic holds, then the output difference in the capacity will be cancelled by the difference in the messages, while the difference in the rate will be delta 1, which would be cancelled locally by our characteristic. Depending on the scenarios, we identified three possible values for the difference delta 1. The first one is the case of no associated data and two messages M and M star, as I described. Then we have two cases of encrypting a no associated data and a message M, and another pair of associated data, some associated data derived from M and empty message. In both, the second pair will produce no ciphertext, however, the tags will be the same and we can use that to forge the verification of the associated data. The tag forgery attack then goes as follows. With a key nonce pair, we ask for the encryption of a random, incomplete message block M and we obtain the ciphertext and the tag. Then we verify whether the differential over the last S-box holds in order to filter out the ciphertext. Since we know the rate part from the message and the ciphertext, we can easily invert the S-box and verify whether the input difference is the delta 2 that we expect. If the verification holds, we can continue by asking for the decryption of the ciphertext shown in step 2, under the related key nonce pair from the characteristic. If the verification does not hold, we change the key nonce pair and repeat. Note here that we can repeat every time with a different key. The attack on the other version of SpoC is very similar to this one. However, it follows different scenario for delta 1 and we forge the verification of the associated data. The data complexity of this attack corresponds to the probability of the characteristic and is 2 to the power 106. The time complexity is measured by SBOC calls instead of encryptions and is 2 to the power 107. We can improve these complexities by having multiple characteristics with the same output difference, delta 1, and in our paper we list some that are some characteristics that can be used. Furthermore, a time memory trade-off can be used by generating a table with all words satisfying the verification condition. And then instead of calling the inverse S-box every time, we can have table lookups. Both our message and key recovery attacks are on SpoC64 and are based on the fact that for SpoC64, the initialization phase is not bijective, meaning that there exist multiple key nonce pairs leading to the same internal state. This happens because the size of the state is smaller than the size of the key and the nonce together. Based on that, we aim for a collision after the initialization phase, and we propose two ways to achieve a collision. Using the differential characteristic that I showed in the beginning, which we apply for the message recovery attack, or a time memory trade-off approach, which we use for our key recovery attack. Our message recovery uses the 9-round characteristic, which is constructed with the constraint to have output difference only in the capacity part. If the characteristic holds, then after the permutation in the initialization phase, the difference will be only in the capacity bits, and we can then cancel it with the addition of the second half of the nonce. After that, the encryption will be identical and the tags would be also the same. The attack goes as follows. With some key nonce pair, we ask for the encryption of an arbitrary unknown plaintext and obtain the ciphertext tag pair. Then we ask for the decryption of this ciphertext under the related key related nonce pair that you can see on step 2. If the tag verification holds, we obtain a plaintext M', and if it is a readable text, then this is the recovered message. I say readable text here because there is always the probability due to the birthday paradox that the tags will collide. If the text is not readable, then we repeat from step 1. The data complexity of this attack is bounded by the probability of the characteristic and is 2 × 2⁻¹. For our key recovery attack, we would formalize things a little. We say that two key nonce pairs are equivalent or in the same equivalence class if the corresponding internal states after the initialization phase are equal. Since the size of the state is 192 bits, we have 2⁻¹ equivalence classes and 2⁻⁴ key nonce pairs in each class. It is important to note that encrypting the same plaintext with equivalent pairs leads to the same ciphertext, and vice versa. Decrypting the same ciphertext with equivalent pairs gives the same plaintext. Our key recovery attack consists of two phases, an offline and an online phase. For the offline phase, the adversary first chooses a commonly used message M. What is a commonly used message? Well, depending on the environment, in many scenarios, it happens that certain blocks occur often as the beginning of a message. For example, if we send an email, we normally start with dear or hello. So here we assume that such a message exists. Then, 2⁻¹ key nonce pairs are generated such that they give different equivalence classes. Finally, a table with 2⁻¹ entries is generated, and in each entry are stored the key nonce pair and the corresponding ciphertext of the chosen message M encrypted under this key nonce pair and the null associated data. For the online phase, we intercept random messages encrypted by a valid user. The adversary then verifies if the first three blocks of the intercepted ciphertext belongs to the table. We choose three blocks because we believe this length is enough to ensure uniqueness. A match would mean that the adversary knows the internal state after the initialization, so to go backwards from this state, the adversary simply XORs with N1, which is the second half of the nonce, and then applies the inverse permutation to recover the initial state and the key. This table summarizes the online and offline complexities together with the total complexity of the attack. The total complexity has 2 to the 67 data, 2 to the 110 time and 2 to the 110 table entries as a memory. Finally, I'll show you an observation of the used constants. Those are the constants used in the permutation and the S-boxes. We notice that even though the designers of Sly SCP claim that the round and step constants are different, in fact some of them are equal. The constants are derived from an LFSR with length 7 and period of 127, which means in particular that the bit of RC0 and the ith step is equal to the RC1 in the E plus 8 step of the permutation. Furthermore, you can see also that the first three pairs in the first table are equal to the last three pairs in the second table. We have not developed this further into attack, but we think it is an interesting observation. To conclude my talk, our attacks and their complexities are summarized in this table. Please note that even though we respect the security claims, our attacks are still theoretical and do not compromise the security of SpoC. However, our key recovery attack, which is the strongest scenario, is a generic attack, which implies that there might be a vulnerability to the mode of operation of SpoC. Thank you again for watching my presentation, and if you have any questions, you can always send them by email or ask them now. Thank you.